If y'all are glad to be here this morning, say amen. Oh, man. Hey, listen. I couldn't even begin to hear that. If you're glad to be here this morning, say amen. It's so great that y'all are here today. We appreciate the fact that you've come here to join us. I've got some announcements to make this morning for y'all that y'all need to remember through the week. Number one, on this Friday night from 6 to 7, we're having a community meal over here in the CLC. What we do, we provide a meal for the people in the community that are hungry, and they come over and have fellowship with us, and we share with them. It's just a great opportunity, and that starts from between 6 and 7. If you'd like to come a little bit earlier, just for preparation time, around 5:30 or so, and that'll help the group that's ahead of it to get everything ready for that. So this Friday night, July 20th, at 6 p.m. To 7, our community meal. Secondly, our Love Our City continues. And what our Love Our City includes some door-to-door visitation, but there are times we also are been doing prayers at schools in the area. And you'll see a list of them up there on the overhead. Monday, July 23rd at 6, they'll be at J. O'Kelly, Sonora Elementary and Sonora Middle School. Then Friday, July 27th at 2 p.m., very unusual time for us, at Helen Tyson Middle School. Then Friday, July 27th at 6, we'll be at Central Junior High, Tyson Elementary, and Walker Elementary. So if you would like to be at any of those or all of them, you're welcome to come. Just show up there and just take that in. It takes some time to pray for our schools. You think about it, gang. That's an amazing opportunity, isn't it? For us to be able to go into schools and pray for those schools. It's a blessing from God, and all those that take part, we really appreciate you doing it. Our next announcement is including our school supply drive for Elmdale Schools. And as you can see in the overhead, they need a number of things: spiral notebooks, tissues, folders. As I'm getting old, I can't read that far. Dry erase markers. But anyway, you can. It should be in the bulletin, possibly. I haven't seen the bulletin this morning, but it should be a list of things they need. We've got some bins back in the back, boxes. You can drop those in anytime you'd like, or you can give a financial donation. You know, you can talk to Sonia how they want to do that. I think you can write a check to, I don't know, where is Sonia? Anyway, if you want to write a check, write it to me, and I'll make sure they get the money. How's that sound? But anyway, that's another thing we do to help our kids in the area who don't have chances to have the school supplies they need, and it really helps them. And we partner with Elmdale School right next door in all the things that they do. The last announcement we have for this morning, tonight we have our Bible study at 6 o'clock, and also following, though, the Bible study, we will have our quarterly business meeting. During that meeting, the Property and Space is going to be sharing a couple of things that they have planning on doing in the future here. And so we'd like you to be here to listen to a little bit of a presentation, but also just be here for our quarterly business meeting. Sonia, I did want to ask, they mentioned about donations about the school supplies. If they made a check out, who would they make that out to? Make it to Elmdale? Okay. And just designate at the bottom what it's for? Okay. You got that? So if you don't have anything to bring physically, go ahead and just write a check, and we'll make sure they get the things that they need. We want to thank you again for being here. If you are a guest, thank you so much for being part of our service. We appreciate you being here. What we're going to do right now is, while some music is playing, y'all can stand up and y'all can greet each other, and in just a moment we'll begin our worship.
This is home. Now I'm finally where I belong, where I belong. Yeah, this is home. I've been searching for a place of my own. Now I'm found it, maybe this is home. Yeah, this is home. Belief over misery.
Now
Okay, thank you all very much. If y'all would like, be seated as our choir opens up our worship section with a great piece called Unto the King. Amen. We're here for all the glory unto the King we sing. This morning, congregation, we're going to be singing a song, a couple hymns today included with our worship set. The first is a great song about the blood of Jesus. I want to make a statement about Jesus' death. It wasn't only his death that purchased our salvation. It was his blood that was shed. He had to die and shed blood. Amen. And what that does, his shed blood that we have put our faith and trust in redeems us. It has purchased our salvation. By grace and grace alone, we'll be singing about amazing grace a little bit later in the service. But he has provided the blood of Christ because of his grace, unmerited mercy that God provides. And we celebrate this morning this fact that God has washed us by the blood of the Lamb. Amen? Let's stand together. And we are going to sing, after I get my capo on my guitar, I'm sorry. Someone stole my capo. We're going to find another capo. Who would do such a thing? All right. This is a cheater. I don't have to make these weird chords, okay? Are y'all ready to sing this great song? Say amen.
For the cleansing power, are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Lay aside your garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood? Let's sing that chorus again. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Let's give the Lord a praise of thanksgiving for the blood of Jesus Christ. We're here this morning because of that blood and because of the love that Jesus has for us. As
As we come into your presence, we remember every blessing that you poured out so freely from above. Lifting gratitude and praises for compassion so amazing. Lord, we come to give you thanks for all you've done. Because of your love, we're forgiven. Because of your love, our hearts are clean.
We've been washed in the blood of Jesus.
We lift you up with songs of freedom. Because of your love. As we come into your presence, we remember every blessing that you poured out so freely from above. Lifting gratitude and praises for compassion so amazing, we come to give you thanks for all you've done. Because of your love, we're forgiven. Because of your love, our hearts are clean. Because of your love.
Sing it again.
Because of your love, we're forgiven. Because of your love, our hearts are clean. We lift you up with songs of freedom. Forever we're changed. Because of your love. Na 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 na.
Come on, let's give the Lord another praise, because we are here because of the love of Jesus. We're here to lift the name of Jesus on high, higher than all names. His name is the greatest name, the only name, the name by which we can be saved. Amen? Let's lift his name this morning on high.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I want to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. You came from heaven do show the way from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high.
A few weeks ago, my wife and I were in California, and we stayed near the ocean. And on the mornings, I would go out and take long walks, and even take walks on the beach. And I remember one morning I was looking out over the ocean. It was so vast and so huge. And a thought occurred to me as I was looking out over that ocean. And I thought about the oceans of people that don't know Jesus. You realize there are many more that don't know him that do. The Word of God says that many are called and few are chosen. The Word of God also says that the way to Jesus, that path, is very, very narrow. The road to destruction is very, very wide, and many people are on it. And it made me realize, and it made me sad to realize, that people who do not choose Jesus are choosing an eternity away from him. And that eternity will never, never, never end. And it's a sobering thought, church. And we have a message to share about the grace of God. And his salvation he provided because of his grace. It was undeserved. It was unmerited. There was nothing we could do to purchase it. There's nothing we could do to get it other than just the fact that it was a free gift. And that grace that he provided is absolutely, unequivocally, totally amazing. This next hymn is one of our most beloved hymns that talks about the grace of God. And when we finish that song, we're going to sing about the only person that could have provided it, and that was Jesus, only Jesus.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious dear that grace appear, the hour I first believed. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already had brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. When we've been there Who has the power to raise the dead? Who can save us from our sin? He is our hope, our righteousness. Jesus, only Jesus. Who can make the blind to see? Who holds the keys that set us free? He paid it all to bring us peace. Jesus, only Jesus. Holy King, Almighty Lord, saints and angels all adore. I join with them who bow before Jesus, only Jesus. Who can command the highest praise? Whose name above all names? You stand alone, I stand amazed. Jesus, only Jesus. Holy King, Almighty Lord, saints and angels all adore. I join with them and bow before Jesus, only Jesus. Holy King, Almighty Lord, saints and angels all adore. I join with them and bow before Jesus, only Jesus. You will command the highest praise. Yours is the name above all names. You stand alone, I stand amazed. Jesus, only Jesus. You will command the highest praise. Yours is the name above all names. You stand alone, I stand amazed. Jesus, only Jesus. Jesus, only Jesus. Jesus, only Jesus.
And all of God's people said, amen and amen. This morning, we're very privileged to have a guest speaker with us today. And Joe has been with us many times before. And y'all may be seated if you'd like to. Go ahead. And Joe is just a dear friend, a wonderful brother who was a pastor for years and years, and now he's in retiring. But he hasn't really retired. He's still serving God, and he's still serving in many, many different ways. And we're so blessed to have him today. So what we want to do this morning is we want to give a welcoming praise through our Lord for Joe Jones this morning. Let's give him a praise this morning. Our God for having Amen. Joe today. Come forward.
Amen.
And Joe, I'd like to pray for you before you begin. How's that sound?
That sounds great.
Heavenly Father, we do thank you, Lord, for the time of worship. We thank you, Lord, that really it is by your grace that we are saved. It's not according to our works. It's not according to anything that we have done. It is just a grace, a privilege provided you as a free gift. We thank you, Lord, for your blood. We thank you for your grace. We thank you that we can come today in this place and worship you. And we thank you for dear brothers like Joe who are willing to come and share in a time of, in our absence of our pastor. I ask God that you would just empower Joe right now to be his very best, that he would deliver the word of God uncompromised, and that your church would be challenged to be their very best for the kingdom. We ask all these things in the powerful and the saving and the healing name of Jesus. Amen and amen.
Amen. Amen. Jeff, it's good to visit with you again. I've known Jeff, like you said, for several years. I believe your wife baked a cake for my daughter's wedding, and so we've got to know each other. I got to know Billy really well when we went kayaking, and with the pastors went on a kayaking trip a couple of years ago, and I got to know Billy, and I just love him. He's a great guy. And it's a privilege to be here. And when you get to come a second time, it's really a privilege. So I'm glad I have that opportunity. I was at camp last week, and the associational camp, and I was the water boy, by the way. I got to go around and make sure that they stayed hydrated, and so that was a good job. But in the evenings, I would go to the youth's worship time. It's really great when you see some people come down to receive Jesus Christ as Lord of their life, isn't it? As a pastor, I'll be honest with you, I got disappointed with nobody came forward and to get saved. And when somebody did, it's just an exciting thing. And I like to hear other churches and other pastors talk about people that have come forward and received Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of their life. I thought, oh man, I just like to hear those stories. I love to hear them. And so we would see that happening at camp. And we see people come down and they receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of their life. And then to see them follow through and to receive believer's baptism and get in those waters and can profess publicly their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, that's an exciting thing as well, isn't it? And then when they finish that, then they join the church. Then they join the church, and then they become involved in a Sunday school or a small group, and they come to worship, and they get involved in the ministries of the church. Then you really get excited, because then you know, boy, they're there. They have become what we would call a disciple. A disciple. And that's what I want to talk about this morning, is not becoming a disciple, but what does it mean to be a disciple? Because I would ask this question: can you be saved and not be a disciple of Jesus Christ? Can you really say you're saved if you are not a disciple of Jesus Christ? And the answer, of course, is no. When you become saved, you become a disciple of Jesus Christ. God did not save us so that we can just avoid hell. God saved us to restore, to renew us to His holiness, to His righteousness, and to transform our lives into the likeness of Jesus Christ. In Romans chapter 8, verse 29, you know, we like verse 8, 28, but 29 is really where it's at, because it says, "For whom He foreknew, He also predestined," and here it is, "to be conformed to the image of His Son." You know, we like to focus on foreknew and predestined, but I see in this verse the real meat is to be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. You see, once saved, you become a disciple of Jesus, and that should change our want to's, that should change our attitudes, that should change our lifestyle. That should change every aspect of our lives. And if not, listen to me. Something's wrong. Something went awry. That doesn't mean that we're perfect. Doesn't mean that we never sin or we never struggle with sin. Paul in Philippians said that he had yet to attain, but he pressed on to the high calling, and that high calling is to be like Jesus. Paul in Romans also said, "I do those things that I don't want to do. I don't do those things that I know I should do," which encourages me. Doesn't it encourage you? That even though I'm not perfect, yet I am a disciple of Jesus Christ because I am working towards that goal of being like Jesus. So I want to look at what it means to be a disciple today. Turn with me in your Bibles to John chapter 15, beginning in verse 1. John chapter 15, beginning in verse 1. What does it mean to be a disciple? What does it look like to be a disciple of Jesus Christ? I think in John chapter 15, they had just finished the Lord's Supper, and they were on their way to Gethsemane. And along the way, they would have passed several vineyards. And as Jesus is accustomed to doing, he probably stopped in one of those vineyards, and he began to give an object lesson. And we begin reading in chapter 15, verse 1. Jesus is speaking. He says, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the vineyard keeper. Every branch in me that does not produce fruit, he removes. And he prunes every branch that produces fruit so that it will produce more fruit. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, and I in you. Just as the branch is unable to produce fruit by itself unless it remains in the vine, so neither can you unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. The one who remains in me and I in him produces much fruit, because without me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not remain in me, he is thrown aside like a branch, and he withers. They gather together, throw them into the fire, and they are burned. If you remain in me, and my words remain in you, ask whatever you want, and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you produce much fruit, and prove to be my disciples." Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for your word here. I thank you for the encouragement. I thank you for the love that just oozes out of these scriptures. And I pray, Father, that you will help all of us to have ears that we might hear these words and we might hear your Holy Spirit as you teach us through these words, and that we might go out and live a life that looks like Jesus, that others may ask why the hope we have within us, and we can tell them. Thank you, Lord, for Jesus. Thank you for your Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord, for your love that just overflows among your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So what he says here about discipleship is that the key to being a disciple is to remain in him. Notice that six times he says this. Five times he uses the word "in me" five times he says "remain in me." Remain in me. And so we see that, and the Old Testament, you've got to understand what Israel thought and his disciples at that time thought. Because what was going through their mind is that all through the Old Testament, Israel was the vine. Israel was considered the vine. So they would have thought, Israel is the vine. We are the vines. And the Jewish thought is that you must become a part of Israel to be a part of Jehovah. That was what their thinking was back then. In fact, even when we go into Acts, we see the Jerusalem Council there was all about that. Because Paul would go around saying, you're saved by grace and grace alone. You're saved by faith and faith alone in the Lord Jesus Christ. And then these others, the Judaizers, the ones who had gotten saved that were from the priesthood, maybe even some of the Pharisees, I don't know, but had gotten saved, they were coming in behind and they were saying, that is great that you have received Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of your life. Now you must become a Jew in order to really seal your salvation. And Paul would say, no, you don't. And they would say, yes, you do. And Paul would say, no, you don't. And they would say, yes, you do. Well, these poor Gentiles were getting confused about all this. And so they sent a group down to Jerusalem to find out what is this. So the church in Jerusalem had this big council and they decided, no, you don't. But that was the issue. And now Jesus was coming and he was saying, not that I am the vine. He's saying something different. He's saying, I am the true vine. I am the true vine, not Israel. I know that's what you learned in the Old Testament, but we're in the New Testament now. We're in the New Covenant now. I have come. I am the Messiah and I am the true vine. And to be a part of Jehovah, you must be a part of me. We must be a part of Christ. And in the scriptures that we've read, Jesus is saying that if you remain in me, if you remain in Christ, you will produce fruit. You're going to produce fruit. But if you don't remain in Christ, if you don't remain in me, you will not produce fruit. That's what it says in verse 2. And he says, I will remove you. Now, I don't think we're talking as much about salvation in these passages or as we're talking about discipleship. So how does he remove a disciple? Well, he could do it one of two ways that I've found in the Bible. One is that you could just not be used by God. He could just put you on the bench or the pew and not use you. Now, if you play sports, you know that the worst thing you hate is to be put on the bench and not get to play. The whole idea is that you practice all week long, and then when the game comes, you're a part of the game, that you're in the game, that you're taking part in all of the action. And the worst place to be for an athlete is on the bench. Well, I will tell you something. Worst place for a preacher or a music minister or a youth minister or even you and I is to be benched by the Lord Jesus Christ because we have not remained in Him. And the second thing is that there's the sin unto death. Now, I don't want to get into a debate on theology of what the sin unto death is. I have no idea. In fact, in 1 John, where it's only mentioned, all it says is there is a sin unto death. Now, some people have argued that Sapphira and Ananias might have committed that when they lied to the Holy Spirit. Some people said Moses might have committed that when he disobeyed God and struck the rock instead of speaking to the rock. I don't know. The Bible just doesn't tell us enough about it except that there is a sin unto death. And we might be surprised how many people are taken on home to glory because they didn't remain in Christ. I don't know. But if you remain in Christ, the Word says you will produce fruit, not you might produce fruit. You will produce fruit. And then what happens? Do we get a medal? Do we get a pat on the back? Do we get applause? No, we get pruned. Now, pruning hurts. And I can only imagine that what Jesus is talking about when he says that if I produce fruit, I'm remaining in Christ and I'm producing fruit, that ouch, he's going to prune me. Maybe a crisis comes in my life. Maybe there's some pain in my life. Maybe there's some persecution, but something comes along that's called pruning. Why? So that I will produce more fruit. More fruit. If you remain in Christ, you will produce fruit and you will be pruned because it's necessary for his disciples to be pruned. I think the example of this might be, now we'll have to get away from the vineyards a little bit. It still works with that, but most of us don't have vineyards in our backyards, but a lot of us have fruit trees, don't we? A lot of us have fruit trees. I've got two apple trees and a peach tree that does well every once in a while. Peaches don't do so well here, do they? But I found out that I've got a lot of small apples. And somebody said you need to prune it because they said you've got a lot of sucker limbs. Anybody heard that term, sucker limbs? Yeah. Okay, I'm just checking to make sure because I'm not a farmer. So there really is such a thing. They're sucker limbs. And these sucker limbs basically are limbs that come out and they don't produce any fruit. And yet they take nourishment and water from the plant itself. And so even though you've got a plant over here that's producing a little bit of fruit, you've got these sucker limbs over here that it's zapping away some of the nutrients and water so that the true limb can't grow better and more fruit. So what do you have to do? you have to get rid of the sucker limbs. You have to clip them off. And once they're clipped off, then what happens is that the ones that are producing, that which is producing the fruit, produces better fruit and produces more fruit. Well, guess what? We have some sucker limbs, don't we? In our lives, that are hanging off our lives. It's those things that are taking away the spiritual nourishment that comes to us by the Holy Spirit. What is keeping you from serving God? What is keeping you from producing much fruit? Well, it could be a habit. You may have a habit that's there, an addiction. It could be sports. It could be a hobby. It could be video games. It could be a bad attitude. Whatever it is that's out there sucking away the nourishment, the spiritual nourishment that Christ wants to give you, is a sucker limb. It's not producing any fruit in your life, and it's got to be pruned. It's got to be pruned. Fruit is the word karpos, which means exactly the same it means in our English. It's a piece of fruit that you would eat, or it could be results. And so, you know, like we would say, he is enjoying the fruit of his labor. He's enjoying the result of his labor. So it means that. So the fruit is the result of being a disciple of Jesus. And the proof of discipleship is fruit. Verse 8 is fruit. So what exactly is that fruit? Well, Paul is the world's best at giving us lists, isn't he? He gives us a list for a lot of things, and he's given us a list for the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians chapter 5, verse 22. Don't need to turn there, but I'm just going to go through those nine that he mentions there. He gives us a list. He leaves off, probably this is an exclusive list. He leaves off the fruit of righteousness, or the fruit of other believers that you invite. But when we look at it, the first one there is love. And of course, the word love there is the word agape, which is an unconditional love, which means I'm going to love you no matter what. It doesn't matter what you do. I am going to love you. Now, when I went to my first pastorate, that's the attitude that I went in. I said, I'm going to love these people unconditionally with an agape love. Now, I got to admit, I had to draw that circle several times bigger. But that's the kind of love that we're talking about. Joy was another one. Joy is the word kara, which we might look at charismatic, not so much the ones that are speaking in tongues, but the charismatic of a personality. You know, we'd say that person is really charismatic. You just like to be around them. And that word literally means, it means you live out your circumstances joyfully, whether they're pleasant circumstances or you're in suffering. Either one. Another one is the word peace. Peace is the right relationship with God and in harmony with humanity. It's a peace that God gives us that no matter if the world is in chaos around us, we have a peace that is evident in our life that comes from God. Patience is another one. It's a quality of mind that takes everything in a good attitude and not be easily offended. Boy, are we easily offended in our country today, aren't we? I mean, if you are out there and just about anything and everything offends somebody, and we've become a nation that's offended. Kindness, even to those who offend us or persecute us, that we demonstrate kindness, goodness, generosity towards others. It's going that second mile. Faith, the acceptance of the gospel and commitment to Christ as Savior and Lord, and to be true and trustworthy and reliable to Christ. Gentleness, a submissive and teachable spirit. And finally, self-control, which is control over our desires and our passions. You see, the fruit are the result is the characteristics of Jesus. If you look at all of those, you'll find those are the characteristics that Jesus has. Isn't that amazing? So it tells me this. The more that I remain in Christ, the more of these characteristics will show, and the more like Jesus I will become. Isn't that good? That's good. So how can we remain in Christ and to demonstrate the spiritual fruit in our lives? And the answer is by keeping His commandments, or, in it, to put it another way, remain in His love. Remain in His love. If we look and we follow through in John chapter 15, beginning in verse 9, as the Father has loved me, I also have loved you. Here it is. Remain in my love. If you keep my commands, there it is. Remain in my love, keep my commands. My commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in His love. Verse 12, this is my command. Love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. And we move on down to verse 17. This is what I command you, love one another. Love one another. Remain in His love. Keep His commandments. There's three things I see there. One is to love God. Very first thing is to love God. Is not this the greatest commandment? Love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy might. That is to love God. And what does that mean? It means that we need to love God with all of our being. Every ounce of us has a love for God. Now, what does that mean? How do we play that out? Well, one, by not having any idols in our lives. Don't have any idols in your life. Don't, if God takes second place, or if there's anything between you and God, it could be anything. It could be something that is not necessarily a sin. It's just something in the way between you and God. That becomes an idol. Now, I don't remember if I shared with you my green car, my Camaro, because this was a lesson I had to learn the hard way. Back in 1969, I purchased my first car, 1968 Camaro. Beautiful green with a racing stripe across and down the sides, a 327 engine, which I thought was the greatest engine ever made. And it had it didn't have a Hurst 4-speed, but it had a Muncie 3-speed, which was my first standard. And so I was just tickled to death with that. I mean, it was fast, and I literally went from coast to coast in that thing. I was in the Navy, and I was stationed in Virginia, so my parents live here, and I'd go back and forth. Then later, I was stationed over in San Diego and Long Beach and around California, so I drove it back and forth like that. Okay, that in and of itself is not a sin to enjoy driving, to have a car you enjoy. And that's what I thought. But apparently, I had moved past that point of just enjoying it to really being focused on it. So much so that when I got saved, it was in between myself and God. It was in between. And so, a little pruning had to take place. I was out in California, weather's beautiful. I thought I needed a convertible, little sports car. So this country boy went down to the city slicker car lot, and they stole my car that had nothing wrong with it and gave me a piece of junk, an 850 Fiat convertible. It ran 4 months out of the year I owned it. I'm telling you, and I believe this to this day, that, and I know it for a fact, that God pruned me with that. It would be about 10 plus years before God would ever let me have a decent car. The next one was a Dodge Dart, six-cylinder Dodge Dart in an ugly brown. My wife had a 68 Mustang. She didn't have any problems. that would be later. But the thing is that the thing I'm trying to bring out is that I had no clue what was going on. I didn't know. I didn't understand, because the car itself was neither bad nor good. But it was what was happening within me. And so I would ask that question: is there something within you that is an idol that you may not even be aware of yet? Let me just tell you, pruning is not fun. It was not fun. So how do we love God with all our being? By not having any idols. Number two, by giving up person, possessions, and purpose. Luke chapter 14, verse 26 says, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, and yet even his own life, he cannot be," what? "My disciple. And whoever does not bear his own cross and come after me," here it is again, "cannot be my disciple." So there's a sense that it's not saying, kids, that we're supposed to hate our parents in the sense of like that. It just simply means that we are supposed to put God so high that even our parents, even our wives and husbands, and nothing comes before Him. Nothing. Let me ask you, what motivates you? God or something else? What lights a fire in your soul? What lights a fire in your soul? And number three, we love God with all our being by developing our relationship with God through prayer and His Word. I don't know any other way that you can strengthen a relationship than by prayer and the Word. And when we have put the Word and prayer aside because our lives get too busy, we're losing our relationship with God. Keep His commandments, and His commandment is to love God. The second is to love one another. John chapter 13, verse 34 says, "I give," here it is, "a new commandment." A new commandment. "Love one another as I have loved you, you must also love one another. By this shall all men know that you are," what? Here it is again, "my disciple, by the love that you have for each other." See, that's it. And we do this by worshiping together, like in church, or fellowshipping with each other in small groups or social events. We do this by spending time with each other. I don't understand people who don't go to church but yet say they're Christians. That doesn't make sense. That doesn't make any sense at all. Because if you love God, you're going to love what God loves. God loves His church. Isn't the church His idea? It's not a denomination idea. People say, well, there's so many hypocrites in church, or it's man-made, or blah, 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 all of that stuff. All the excuses that they give for not going to church. And I'm saying, look, who started the church? Did not Jesus start the church when He said, "On this I will build my," what? Church. The church was God's idea. It wasn't the Southern Baptist Convention's idea, or the Assembly of God's idea, or the Catholic's idea. It was God's idea. He's the one that developed it. He's the one that thought about it. He's the one that put it together with the blood-bought people that He has saved. It's His idea. So to say that I'm not going to go to church because it's man-made, or because there's hypocrites down there, or whatever, just doesn't make sense. Folks, to keep His commandments, to remain in His love, you will love God and you will love one another. And three, you'll love others. You will love others. Isn't that the second part of the great commandment? To love your neighbor as yourself. To love your neighbor as yourself. Oh, folks, we need to realize something. We need to realize that the individual person you know, just put somebody in your mind who you know that's lost. It could be a family member. It could be a friend. But somebody that you know that's lost, get them in your mind right now. That person will die and spend eternity in hell if they do not receive Jesus Christ. Now listen to me. If we really believe that, If we really cared about that person who doesn't know Christ and loved that person, would we not do anything and everything in our power to make sure that they hear the gospel of Jesus Christ whereby they might be saved? Why is it we don't do that? Why is it we put this off? Got a friend over here, we've known him for years and we've never given them the gospel of Jesus Christ. We have relatives that we've never given the gospel of Jesus Christ to. People that we know. I don't know, maybe it's that hell just seems to be so distant out there. I don't know. But I know this. God loves them more than we do. And he has called us, he's privileged us to tell people and give them the gospel of Jesus Christ whereby they might be saved. And you know what? Here's the neat thing about the new commandment to love. It's one we can do. We can't keep the law. Anything in the Old Testament, we were not able to keep any of it, but we can love. We have the capacity to love. That we have. We can love. And that's the new commandment. That's the new commandment. Avery Willis, I'm pretty sure y'all have heard him. He probably is known for he was a missionary to Indonesia mostly, but he wrote something called Master Life. Years and years ago, he wrote something called Master Life, which a lot of people used in discipleship. And matter of fact, I teach at Ecclesia College, and I was teaching a course called Spiritual Life. And I was trying to figure out what kind of discipleship book I could use as a textbook. And I looked at the new stuff that was out there, and I still went back to Master Life because I think it's that good. But before Avery went to college, he says he tithed, he read his Bible daily, he went to church, he did everything that the church asked of him. But then when he went off to college, he was faced with who he really was. And he says this, and I'm quoting from him out of that book. I realized that I possessed Christ as my Savior, but that he did not possess me. Am I going to be a disciple who gives everything to Christ? What a question for us today. What a question for us today. You've been saved. You're a disciple of Jesus Christ. But does he really possess you? Am I going to be a disciple who gives everything to Christ? Will you bow your heads? And I want you to think of those questions right now. Get personal with God. Allow the Holy Spirit to speak to you right now. Am I a disciple that gives everything to Christ? Is there some pruning, oh Lord, that you need to do on my life? And what are some of those sucker limbs? Think about that in your life right now. What are some of those sucker limbs? Just stay in an attitude of prayer for a moment. And let me just say, there might be some folks here today. I don't know. There might be some folks here today, and you would say, I'm not a disciple of Jesus Christ. I've never invited Jesus to come into my life to be my Lord and Savior. I've gone to church all my life, but I've never done it. I believe in God, but I've just never given my all to him. And I know I'm not a disciple. That's the Holy Spirit speaking to you, by the way. That's not this preacher. And if that's you this morning, while everyone is praying and considering the sucker limbs in their lives and the pruning that needs to be done and asking God to do that while others are doing that, I'm going to invite you to come forward, and there'll be somebody down here to speak to you about becoming a Christian. Just tell them, I'm not saved. I need Jesus. I want to know how to be saved. I want to become a disciple. If that's you, just stand and walk down here, and somebody will receive you. Privilege it is to be here this morning to worship you. It's so easy to come here and sing songs and our hearts just warm up to your Holy Spirit moving across this assembly, speaking to our hearts, touching our souls, and giving us such joy in worship. We can only imagine what that will be like in heaven. But Lord, we know that you've called us to live here until that day when you take us home. And that, Lord, we need pruning in our lives. There's things in there that we might not even be aware of until after you've snapped off that sucker limb, that the nourishment might flow and the fruit might grow larger and multiply in our lives as we remain in you. And that that fruit may bloom out into a tremendous love for you, for each other, and for others. Lord, make us and mold us to your will. For it's in the precious, wonderful name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
Maybe today that someone would like to come down and talk to someone in front about their heart, the place they are. Maybe someone here does not know Jesus, and Roy Brister will be down here in a moment. Maybe someone here that wants to join our body here, and he'll be here to stand and pray with you, and we'll be glad to receive you at our church. So let's just take one more moment to just bow quietly. If anyone feels they need to come down, maybe just the altar to pray, or come down to pray with Roy, you're welcome to do that. But let's just close our eyes, bow for just a moment, give ourselves a couple more moments before we have our morning offering today. Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus. Jesus. Oh, for grace to trust Him more. Thanks, Roy. Appreciate it very much. If our men will come down at this time to take our morning offering, we really appreciate that. If our ushers will come at this point. As you know, it's a very important part of our service. It is a part of worship, too, when we come and give and share the first fruits of what God has provided for us. When you all give, many, many people glean from it. We thank you for your obedience. We thank you for your giving today. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this time that we'll have for morning offering. We thank you for the many blessings you have bestowed upon us, Lord. You have provided all that we have. And we just turn right around and give it back to you, saying, Lord, thank you. And we ask that you would use this offering for your glory. We love you and we praise you. And we ask these things in the powerful and saving name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Appreciate it. Well, if you are blessed today, say amen. And let's just give the Lord a praise and thanks for Joe again. We appreciate having him today. We appreciate it, Joe. I want to remind you that tonight at 6 o'clock, we'll have a church service right here in this room. And following that Bible study, we will have a business meeting, or a quarterly business meeting, as important one as all our meetings are. But because of the fact that tonight the Property and Space Committee will be sharing a little bit with us. Let's stand together. We're going to have a word of prayer, and we will be dismissed today. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for really a wonderful morning, Father, where we were to praise you. We thanked you. We praised you for your blood. We thanked you and blessed you, Father, for forgiveness and for the grace you provided through which we are saved. We thank you for Joe to remind us, Lord, that we are indeed the branches grafted into the vine. And Father, that relationship is so incredibly important that we're grafted in and we stay, remain in Christ because we want to bear fruit in our lives. And we thank you for the reminder that that was. We thank you, Lord, that today, that somehow, some way in this room, there were decisions made. Maybe they didn't come forward, but Lord, something, someone said yes to you. Someone sought forgiveness for sin. Someone had thought about relationships that had been severed and need to be resolved. And whatever those things may be, Lord, we ask that you'll continue to remind them and use this service today where we celebrated you and worshiped you as a reminder of taking care of things they need to in order to stay grafted into the vine. Lord, we do thank you for this day. We ask that you'll give all of us a great day of afternoon of rest. Bring us back safely tonight as we get into the word of Colossians and as we do your church business. And we ask all these things in the powerful and the saving and the healing name of Jesus.